Wow. Well, why don't we just enter into a moment of prayer again. Father, we thank you for this incredible symbol on what we celebrate as our Valentine's weekend. But I think every day is Valentine's Day where you are. But Lord, this weekend it's ours, and you shower us with bridal love. You shower us with, Lord, a picture of what is to be the depths of your heart, encountering the depths of ours. And so this morning we welcome you to continue to pour out the spirit of revelation and wisdom and the knowledge of Christ Jesus. Amen. Well, it's great to be here again this morning. I love this weather, actually. Just something exhilarates inside of me when I see it. It's beautiful. I think it's a sin when the weather goes above zero during the wintertime. Sorry. It's much healthier as well. But it is our Valentine's Day weekend, and it's my prayer that our hearts get really touched, and that, you know, touched with the revelation of the love of our bridegroom God this morning, because I want to talk to you really about what I believe is in his heart, which is a bridal love for his people, and how he's paved things throughout the scriptures that I believe will open up our hearts to see. It's interesting because here we are, and we are blessed. You know, it's the sovereignty of God that you were born where you were, when you were, to the parents that you were born in. I remember years ago we were told by John and Paula Sanford that if you didn't like being who you were and you really argued against God with it and you hated yourself and hated your circumstances, hated your birth, hated your place of birth, you know, the color of your skin, whatever, it could really be equated to a degree of spiritual rebellion, because the Lord created you where he created you and put you where he put you. And he's created you to shine where he's created you to shine. And so this morning I rejoice in where we're at, but every now and again I think, you know, Lord, I feel a little bit underprivileged in the area of the fact that we didn't have the benefit of being able to see the Hebrew scriptures that our scriptures were based on. We don't have that Hebraic mindset in the way we think. And I realize that we miss out on so much because we don't. But this morning, my prayer is that not only do you have a degree of revelation that we bring forth, but that it'll touch our hearts, because I believe that that's the heart of the Lord. And so I've got a couple of goals this morning. Number one, I want to provoke you to study the Word of the Lord a little bit more, to dig into the Word of God, because I'm hoping by the grace of God to unveil a few things that I think will hopefully excite you. I want to give you a preview into the wedding that's to come, because it's glorious, and I think the Lord has done it so much better than I could, because he's just shown us this beautiful bridal veil. And I also want to provide a small preview as to what to expect for our seminar that's taking place at the end of next month. We have John and Christy Eisner talking to us about understanding the feasts of the Lord, and specifically the spring feasts. And it's a topic that I think very few of us really have understanding of, and I think I'm just like baby steps, you know, just starting the journey. But there's so much there, and I believe it gives understanding to what else is in the scripture. And so I'm going to give a bit of a preview, and she's going to go into so much more detail, or they are, on the 31st of March and April 1st. By the way, who was here for Barry Adams? You know, Father Heart Weekend? I was here Friday night. Yesterday I was with my kids, because my wife is in England right now, but she was watching. Yeah, oh, is she? God bless her. But it was great, and I want to say, too, that there's a book that she's got. I want to give honor to her, as well as Mark Neugebauer. I stole some of his PowerPoints and have talked to Mark in the past, but she's got a book called Finding the Afikoman, which she's going to be selling when they're coming next month. But there's a saying that goes on. It says, the new is in the old concealed, and the old is in the new revealed. And it's this joining together between the old and the new covenant and the realities and the benefits and the blessings of each. And Proverbs 25 also declares that it's the glory of God to conceal a matter, but it's the glory of kings to search a matter out. Now, how many kings and queens do we have here this morning? We're royalty. We want to dig deep into the things of the Lord. And I know that, you know, it's his heart to reveal to us what we will be enjoying throughout eternity. And so I'm going to look at the central theme that we see throughout the scriptures, which is a central theme of this bridal paradigm about a wedding that was there in Genesis. It's there at the end of Revelation, and we're going to take a peek into it. Even Gary Weens in his book Bridal Intercession made the comment where he says, we're created and redeemed for romance. And so we're going to show a few little slides here. Guys at the desk, we only need to put them up for you know, a little bit at a time. But, you know, the first, I just want to comment on the very first miracle that Jesus did. Come on. I trust this is working. There we go. It was a wedding at Cana. The way he chose, the place that he agreed to reveal his glory at the very beginning was in John chapter 2, was at a wedding. And what an amazing prophetic picture that we begin to look at as he provides his very first miracle at this wedding in Cana. And, you know, this bridal paradigm is strongly seen, not just there, but this place of romance is seen in the feast that the Lord calls his own feasts. And Leviticus chapter 23 gives us this great pattern that we begin to look at. And we spend a lot of our time in the New Testament, but there's these incredible secrets right there in Leviticus 23. So I'm going to give you your homework right now to say, when we go home today, look at Leviticus 23. Because I'm not going to read through it all, but I'm going to take little peeks at it. But the consuming passion and the intense focus of God's heart from the time of Adam's fall in the garden to the very end of time where we begin to see... Where we see the scriptures in Revelation, it's to redeem a people and it's to redeem a planet through 6,000 years of history. And he takes us, whoa, come on. We're going back a little bit. All right, guys, maybe we need new batteries in this. Okay, that's okay. Anyway, if I can get you to do it, just take me to the next slide, please. And so we see that the culmination of the heart of God is in Revelation chapter 19, starting at 6, which says, "Then I heard like the voice of a great multitude saying, 'Hallelujah, for the Lord our God, the Almighty reigns. Let us rejoice and be glad and give glory to him, for the marriage of the Lamb has come and his bride has made herself ready.'" Next slide. Okay. I'm just going to put this right away. Oh, there you go. I'm going to put this away. I'll just direct you if that's okay. So if you can take me back. Turn this right off. Take me back to the next slide of 21, 2 to 4. Where it says, "And I saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride, adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, 'Behold, the dwelling place of God is with man, and he will dwell among them, and they will be his people, and God himself will dwell among them, and will be among them.'" And so we see this passion of the heart of God that culminates right there in these particular passages. And, you know, I've recognized in my journey as a believer that many of us, when we look at the book of Revelation, we've got a sense of a little bit of intrepidation, and many people just haven't gone there because of the what they feel is the concern of what's it all about, and there seems to be so many different understandings of where it's at. But, you know, I picture that John, the beloved, that put his head on the breast of Jesus, you know, receiving this incredible revelation and calling it the revelation. But it's about this word apocalypse. And, you know, you and I, when we think of the word apocalypse, we probably think of the movie that came out and all these disastrous realities. But you know what the word revelation means? It essentially means the word apocalypse. But the word apocalypse actually means unveiling. And so throughout Scripture, we see this reality, we see this evidence of a bridal paradigm where there's this unveiling of the bride. There's this preparation in our heart where even in this book, there's an unveiling that begins to take place, where the whole book is ultimately, I believe, about a wedding. You know, Genesis right through to Exodus, you see this bridal paradigm coming through where it's wedding language and it's wedding understanding. And it's fascinating that the book of Revelation carries more references to Old Testament scriptures, both through indirect citations as well as direct citations and allusions, than any other book of the Bible to the Old Testament. There's actually 243 of them. I found a list and I counted them. 243 illustrations, allusions, both direct and indirect, that lead you to the Old Testament. And so here's the Apostle John, you know, seeing this vision, beginning to record the things that the Lord shows him on the Isle of Patmos, and he would have an understanding of most of what he sees because it is coming specifically from the very Hebrew scriptures that he himself was well versed in. And so for you and I to have an understanding that much of it is actually is directly from or indirectly from the Old Testament scriptures, I believe both brings a uniting and a knitting together of Genesis right through Revelation and the knitting together of all the scriptures, but also a sense of passion that it really is a crucial book, and it's crucial to understand that apocalypse or revelation means the unveiling or the revealing, an unveiling of who we are. And I can picture John when he begins to see what we just read in Revelation 21 or in 19, you know, how the bride, the veil being lifted from the bride, that his heart would have been very undone by the reality, because even in Ephesians chapter 5, when we see the passage about the bridegroom, about the Jesus loving the church and how husbands are called to love their wives even as Christ loves the church. Next slide, please. And they're called to love in that same capacity, where it says that, you know, he gave himself up for her that he might present to himself the church in all of her glory. And in the same way, in the book of Revelation, Jesus presents this bride who is unveiled, and he begins to offer her for the whole world to see in her dazzling glory and in her dazzling beauty. And so it's a picture that we see in Ephesians 5. It's a picture, again, that we begin to see in the book of Revelation as John records the vision of what it is that he sees, because Jesus presents her having no spot or wrinkle or any such thing. Now, here's my question for you. Do you have a picture of yourself as being completely perfected? Completely perfected, beautiful, without spot, without wrinkle. Because I believe that the picture that the Lord is even providing for us today is the beauty of the purity and the absolute whiteness, such as snow that comes down. That when he looks at you, and even when the world will gaze upon you in your finished product. Now, he finishes things before he starts them. We're still working through this process of sanctification. And yet, at the end time, when he returns, we will be a bride without spot or wrinkle. Invited into this bridal paradigm, invited into this understanding of the apocalypse, the unveiling, the being made ready for this incredibly beautiful time. And so there's an unfolding love story that begins to take place. And where do we begin to read about it? Well, you can read about it throughout Scripture, but I'd suggest one of the key places that you can see evidence taking place that, again, next month with the Eisners, you're going to talk about it a lot more, but is in Leviticus chapter 23. And so I want us, and you can turn, if you've got your Bibles with you, or your iPad or iPhone or whatever you've got with you, you can turn your Bibles and your electronic device, and you can turn to that particular area. But, you know, I believe that this isn't just the story for the Jewish people. I believe it's the story for all of us. And it's the story for you if you'll jump into it. If you'll get into this story, it's our story. And it's a love story that Jesus has with a bride that he deeply desires that has been going on for 6,000 years. And even as we've declared in the emphasis of the Father heart of God, that the Father lost his kids in the garden, and he's taken 6,000 years, he's taken all of redemptive history to do whatever he can do to get us back as his sons and daughters. I believe in the same format, Jesus Christ, the bridegroom, Yeshua, is longing for a bride that he lost in the garden. And the story of redemptive history is all about him being able to get this bride back, prepared, pure, holy, without spot, without wrinkle, to not only be with him, but to be with him in the place that he prepares for her to be. And so we recognize that when all was lost in the garden, the Lord made a plan. He provided a way for us to be restored, to be redeemed, to be perfected in all of our ways, that we don't remember our pasts. We don't remember the sin and the defilement, but rather we are fully with him in all ways, that we're pure in our hearts and in our thoughts, that we gaze upon his beauty. And the blueprint of his plan of redemption is in the feasts of Leviticus chapter 23. There is revelation there for those of you that are kings or queens that are willing to search a matter out. There's revelation that we're going to begin to see unveiled to give us understanding, so that this dream that is in the heart of God for final redemption stays alive. And so I'm going to very quickly mention to you the feasts that are there, because I know some people I talk to say, I don't know anything about the feasts. You know, what are the feasts? And it's going to take a lot longer than we've got this morning to go into them. But there's spring feasts and there's fall feasts. There's four spring feasts. There's three fall feasts. The spring ones are the Feast of Passover, the Feast of Unleavened Bread, the Feast or the Festival of the First Fruits of the Barley Harvest, and the Feast of Weeks, known as Passover or Shavuot. And they're rife with meaning. They're full of incredible symbolism that speaks to our situation today, that declares what has already taken place, but also speaks to what shall be. The last three festivals that happen in the fall harvest time, also known as the latter rain, are the Feast of Trumpets, and then there's Yom Kippur, which is the Day of Atonement, and then finally there's the Feast of Tabernacles, and the symbolism again is glorious. And so my question to you, and perhaps it's a question in response to some of the questions that I believe you might be even having in your heart, is well, aren't those really Jewish feasts? You know, why do we want to partake of that? Isn't that Old Testament? Isn't that Old Covenant? Like, aren't we beyond that? And my question to you then is, well, let's look at the New Covenant time. Let's look at the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, where Jesus very clearly and plainly spoke to his disciples, and he said he gave these to those disciples, to the 12 or to the 70 that were with him. And, you know, they were promises given to them as a Jewish people at that time. Now, my question is, do you take those promises for yourself today? Do we take them for ourselves? You know, I believe as a disciple, I take those. Well, in the same way, Paul the Apostle speaks in Romans chapter 11 that we've been grafted into a vine. Now, it's not a dead vine. It's not a useless vine that you throw away. It's a vine that it says is full of the richness and the fatness, you know, the bounty and the beauty of what was given to the Jewish people. Because the plan of the Lord from the beginning of all times is that we would all be saved, that whosoever will can come. But his intention is as he would start by giving it to a people group called the Jewish people, and then they would be blessed so that they could be a blessing to the earth. So it's kind of like the order of God, the divine order. He gives it to them so that they would walk it out in its fullness so that all of us would experience it. And in their case, there's a hardness of heart, there's a hidden face of God, and the Lord says, well, because of that, I'm going to go to the Gentiles. But the grand drama and the plot and the plan is that at the end of the age, there'd be one new man in Messiah, a bride of Christ, not a harem, but a bride that together would come and look to the bridegroom and be betrothed, not just betrothed, but consummated wedding ceremony with him. And so for me, I look at what is spoken to the disciples by Jesus, and I say, I'll receive that. I'll take that as mine. And I look to some of the promises and to the promises that are given and the things that the Lord speaks of in the Old Testament, of course, with understanding, because certain things have been fulfilled in Christ Jesus from the Old Covenant passages. So understand what I'm saying and what I'm not saying here. But there's a reality that these promises and these things were written for our benefit today as we grow and as we mature into it. And so let's begin to look at the first verse of Leviticus chapter 23, where it says, the Lord spoke again to Moses, and there's a slide for this, if you could turn to it, saying, speak to the sons of Israel and say to them, the Lord's appointed times, which you shall proclaim as a holy convocation. Now, those words, the Lord's appointed times, first of all, speak to the fact then that they're not the Jewish appointed times. They're the Lord's times. This is my God and your God. And so he's beginning to state, I want these to be done as holy convocations. They're my appointed times. They're the Moed. I'm probably mispronouncing that. But it means, that word Moed means appointment or an appointed time. And these are his times that we are to proclaim or to recite, to read aloud as a holy convocation, meaning it's just not just a congregation, but it's a solemn assembly when you gather on a regular basis to essentially rehearse these things. They're appointed times where we have rehearsals, like a dress rehearsal. And in essence, when you look at the whole realm of Scripture, they're dress rehearsals to prepare you for the thing that is most real and the deepest in the heart of the Father and in the Son, none other than a wedding. How many of you had a rehearsal when you got married? Had a rehearsal. I've officiated at many rehearsals, and there's times where the people didn't show up for the rehearsal. Makes things rather complicated, especially if it's either the bride or the groom when that happens. But You know, it's better to not show up at the rehearsal and be there for the wedding day, I guess. And so, continuing on from there, that word moed in the next slide, Genesis 1:14. And then God said, let there be lights in the expanse of the heavens to separate the day from the night, and let them be for signs, which really means pledges or omens or prophetic events, and for seasons and for days and for years. Well, the word that was translated appointed times in another place is translated feast or appointed feast is translated seasons here. And so the Lord is saying that even in the skies above, he said, I'm going to put these stars and the moon and everything in the sky so that they could serve as prophetic events and seasons, meaning feast days, appointments for the days and for the years. And so for those of us that are willing to search a matter out, we're beginning to see that the Lord is veiling, is keeping hidden, not hidden from you, but hidden for you, the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven, so that we have a bit of a glimpse into the passion that so burns on the heart of our bridegroom, Jesus, our King. And so what an incredible reality. And jumping into the next verse of Leviticus 23, verse 2, I don't know if I put that on a slide or not, but again, the word holy convocation, it's the Hebrew word mikra, meaning again, dress rehearsal. And so these seasons are in place. And so we want to be prepared for the dress rehearsal. For what reason? So that we don't miss it when it comes. I remember John Arnott speaking once and stating that, you know, how incredible when the Spirit of God was poured out in this place. And when the Spirit of the Lord comes into a city, it is absolutely amazing because that city has an encounter with the Lord. But the tragedy is when something happens in your city or in your church and you completely miss it because you reject it for whatever reason. I believe it's tragic that people in the city of Toronto have missed out on the incredible bounty and abundance of what has been poured out here in the last 23 years or and even more, but that period of time. And so the Lord does not want us to miss it. And so he says, I want you to do these things as dress rehearsals. You know, and it's noteworthy too that, you know, here as those that are in a Western mindset, we tend to read that we would read things and we'd read it again. But the Hebrew mindset is very much that it's not just cerebral like the Greek learning, but it involves the senses and the emotions as well as their minds. So that the Lord would say to the Jewish people in the Old Covenant, he says, I want you not just to read about it, I want you to experience the truth by partaking of it, which is why there's always food. You know, there's honey that represents sweetness. There's horseradish that represents the bitterness in the Passover feast. There's so many types and symbols that help us to not just know it here, but to experience it at an absolute heart level. And so God wants us to experience these things so that our hearts are reminded about who he is. Again, I recall that John Arnott has stated on numerous occasions, he says, you know, the heart is a slow learner. And I thought, I agree with you. My heart has been a slow learner on so many things. And, you know, if we study in such a way that we just read and read and read, you know, it's going to get stuck in your intellect. I want my spirit man to come alive. I want to be awakened to the emotion and to the not only my own emotion, but his emotion when he considers when we consider the passion that he carries for this wedding that is to come. And so in Leviticus 23:4, it goes on and declares that these are the appointed times of the Lord. They're holy convocations which you shall proclaim at the times appointed for them. The Lord put a demand upon his people in that time. He says, you are supposed to do this. It's like a parent speaking to their kids. You shall do this. This is what you've got to do. I am putting in my demand for you so that you will know these, you know, you will proclaim them. You know, and that word proclaim, by the way, means you'll bid them to come. You'll invite them. Because wouldn't it be horrible to know that there's a wedding and we don't show up? But yet in the New Testament, Jesus gives a parable. And he makes this parable, this declaration in Matthew 22. There's a slide for this, starting at verse 3. And he says, he sent out his slaves to call those who'd been invited to the wedding feast, and they were unwilling to come. And again, you see the passion of his heart. Again, he sent out other slaves saying, tell those who've been invited, behold, I prepared my dinner. My oxen and my fattened livestock are all butchered and everything is ready. Come to the wedding feast. To hear the cry of his heart, come to the wedding feast. I want you there. I want you to be a part of it. You know, come to this feast. And so, you know, the vulnerability of his heart, because I believe the most painful thing that any of us can ever experience is when the vulnerability of our love is poured out upon, whether it be many or whether it be few, but our love is scorned. Have you ever had your love scorned? It hurts. In some cases, it's called divorce. We have a divorce recovery taking place, Lillian. You know, people on Wednesday night going through it because it's a pain that goes deep. Because as we're vulnerable to pour out love, we're looking and longing for people to respond to us. Whether it be the intimacy of a husband and a wife, or whether it be a community of believers that are demonstrating love in a way that they would like to receive love. We talked about our love languages in our parenting course on Wednesday nights, and it's one of those things. And so the Lord is saying, come to the wedding feast, because I'm longing to pour my love out upon you. And he wants to rehearse the things that are there. He wants us to attend the dress rehearsal and to experience it as a community, because it's a picture of him, and there's clues there as to what we need to do to reclaim that place of love as the bride of Christ, to be reclaimed into the plan that the Lord has for us. And so we see these references to these wedding feasts, the feasts of the Lord, and to the wedding feast to come. We see them throughout Scripture. And, you know, I want you to know that the marriage that took place even in the Jewish customs, in the times of the Jewish people, were initiated and they were arranged by the father of the groom, you know, but also by the parents of the bride because they participated in it. And so once the prospective bride in those situations was chosen, the bridegroom would go to her parents' home and would take four important things with her. And again, understanding the customs that I believe the Lord gave to the Jewish people is absolutely fascinating, because we see the symbol or the typology or the fulfillment of those in our day and age. So there's four things that the bridegroom, the prospective bridegroom, the bridegroom full of desire, longing for his bride, would take with him. First would be a skin of wine. And if the parents, if the bride's parents would agree to the proposal, the hopeful bridegroom would pour a cup of wine known as the cup of betrothal. And they would drink of that wine together if she were to accept this proposal. And by drinking that glass of wine, it would make the engagement official. And in many well-to-do families and a lot of families in that culture and that custom, they would then, in the ancient cultures, Eastern cultures, they would then have a banquet of wine where they would have three things that took place. They would, number one, honor the decision that was made by the bride to come to the bridegroom as the betrothal took place. They would show off the beauty of the bride, and they would also show off the wealth of the bride's family. So there would, you know, there'd be different presents, and it'd be a really great hoopla. And there's evidence in Scripture of these things that took place. For example, in the book of Esther, Ahasuerus and Vashti would have been a banquet of wine. The Song of Songs, you know, he brought me to his banqueting table and his banner over me is love. You know, we see it also in the time when John the Baptist was about to be beheaded, where Herod and Herodian were there. And it's noteworthy that both Ahasuerus with Esther and Herod would make the comment, you know, what is it that you want of me? And I'll give it to you up to half my kingdom. And so this would be a banquet of wine. The second thing that the bridegroom would take in hopes that the bride would accept the proposal would be called a mohar, which would be money, or it would be a bridal price, and it would be paid to the bride's parents. You know, there's been times that I wish I was raised in an Eastern culture. I have five daughters. You know, somehow or other, I don't know what happened. We got mixed up here in our Western culture, but they would give a mohar, you know, the bridal price. The third thing would be a marriage contract called a ketubah. And it was signed to show that they were legally married. Now, it's noteworthy that when this was signed, the bride, from that day on, from this day of the betrothal, whenever she would enter into the public place, she would be completely veiled, because it was a sign again that she's betrothed and the marriage would already take place. And it's also noteworthy that to break this agreement that they've made, they would have to go through a legal divorce at that point in time. And the marriage hadn't been consummated yet, but it was a season and time, and that legal divorce papers would need to be signed, even though the consummation hadn't happened. And the fourth thing is that the bridegroom would leave gifts for the bride as a pledge for his return. He'd say, I'm going to give you a gift. I'm bringing you a gift because it's a promise. It's a pledge of a covenant that I am making, that I will return for you once again. But first, I have to go, and I have to build a wedding chamber. I have to build this chamber in onto my father's house. And so at that place, you know, it's the second part of the wedding would take place at the groom's father's house. The first part of the wedding took place at the bride's parents' house. And so he's there needing to make this bridal chamber so that they could complete the consummation, which was known as the second part of the wedding. Now, once the chamber was built, the father would inspect it to ensure that it met all the specifications of what he would need, meaning the father of the groom. And then at that time, he would release his son to go and get his bride. At that point in time, when the huppah or the bridal chamber was made, he said, okay, you can go and get her now. You can kidnap or abduct your bride. And it was at this point in time that the phrase, in this wedding talk, this wedding ceremony, at this point in time, the actual phrase, no man knows the day or the hour, only the Father. That's where that phrase came from. And it was used to describe when the bridegroom would go and kidnap and abduct his bride. And so when the father of the groom was satisfied that everything was in order, usually it would take a year or so, and oftentimes it would be at midnight, the friends of the bridegroom would then blow a shofar, and they would proclaim in the streets, behold, the bridegroom cometh. You know, the bridegroom's coming. And they would shout this in the street. And then the bridegroom would go forth with a procession to the bride's house, usually at midnight, to abduct the bride from her home. And for this reason, the bridegroom was called a thief in the night. You see what I'm saying? If we don't have understanding of some of these idioms and customs, we're thinking according to a Western mindset. And so be a thief in the night because he would come suddenly at an hour unknown to the bride, and she had to be in a place of watching and living with the expectation that he would be coming at any minute. Which is profound. And so the four men would carry this carriage known as a palanquin, and they would carry it on their shoulders to take the bride back to the groom's house at that point in time. Now, this was known as the nisun, something like that, also referred to as the catching up or the taking up, also known as the rapture. As the bride is lifted up by the friends of the bridegroom that would take him back to the bridegroom's house. And so at that point in time, the second part of the wedding, which I already referred to as the consummation, it would be performed and it would be sealed with another cup of wine that was called the cup of consummation. The bride and groom would then enter the bridal chamber known as the huppah for 7 days to consummate the wedding. Okay, just think of that, 7 days. So, so the friends of the bridegroom would then stand at the door, I'm assuming towards the end of that, and announce they're coming out from the huppah to the family and the friends who were waiting for the wedding feast to begin. Now let's look at all this symbolism, and let's look at how this relates. Jesus, the bridegroom, chose a bride by the will of the Father. It was the Father that decided who the bride would be. John 15, verse 16, it says, you did not choose me, but I chose you. Jesus set up a banquet of wine in the upper room the night before he was to die. It's a big banquet of wine that took place at that point. John chapter 14, verse 3, Jesus says that something that only a bridegroom would say at his betrothal. He says this, if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. Isn't that awesome? In Mark chapter 13, verse 32, it says, but of that day or hour no one knows, not even the angels of heaven nor the Son, but the Father alone knows that day and hour. In Matthew 25, and you can go to the next slide, you know, we see the story of the 10 virgins. You know, I'm not going to go through that all, but again, it's this incredible parable or story that relates to this wedding feast that we're referring to. And just prior to that, in Matthew chapter 24, verses 42 to 44, he tells them, and he says this, Jesus speaking again parabolically, he says, therefore, be on the alert, for you do not know which day your Lord is coming. But be sure of this, that if the head of the house had known at what time the thief was coming, he would have been on the alert and would not have allowed his house to be broken into. For this reason, you also must be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an hour when you do not think that he will. Did you get that? Let's be ready. And then he tells them to stay alert because he's coming like a thief in the night at an hour that they do not think. And so the next thing that's just fascinating is the bridal price. Guess what the bridal price was that was made? The bridal price, according to 1 Peter 1 verse 18, says this, knowing that you were not redeemed with perishable things like silver or gold from your futile way of life inherited from your forefathers, but with precious blood, as of a lamb unblemished and spotless, the blood of Christ. That was the bridal price. He demonstrated his love for us in this, that while we were still in our sin, Christ died for us. Is that bridal price? You know, for the joy, it says in Hebrews chapter 12, for the joy set before him, he endured the cross because he was longing for a bride in the same way that the father was longing for his kids to come back again. And so 1 Corinthians 7:23 reminds us that we've been bought with a price. Your life is no longer your own. You've been bought. Acts chapter 2 tells us about the gift that Jesus left to serve as a guarantee or of a pledge, or elsewhere it's known as a down payment of what was to come. And of course, that gift was the Holy Spirit. He gave us his Holy Spirit as this gift because the bride had accepted the sacrifice, had accepted the invitation. Let's go to the next slide, please. Paul, the Apostle Paul, speaks in 2 Corinthians 11:2, and he reminds us, he says, I'm jealous for you with a godly jealousy, for I betrothed you to one husband so that to Christ I might present you as a pure virgin. You see, he longs for our purity. You know, we all have a life that is impure in the past, but the blood of Jesus cleanses us from all unrighteousness. And so even as we are cleansed of what has been in the past, we now get to operate and function in a way that we walk in purity. 1 John 1:9 says, if you confess your sins, he is faithful and he's just to forgive you your sins and to cleanse you from all unrighteousness. Next slide, please. John 3:29 identifies that John was the friend of the bridegroom. Now, why does Jesus say in Mark chapter 2 to his disciples, do not fast now because the bridegroom is with them, but they will fast when he's taken away? Remember that? When the disciples of John the Baptist came to Jesus and his disciples, why don't your disciples fast, you know? Our disciples are fasting, why aren't yours fasting? And he says it's because they don't fast now while the bridegroom is with them, but they will when he's taken away. Because Jesus knew that at that point he was about to initiate his betrothal ceremony, and then he would go away on a long journey to prepare a place. He knew that in advance, so he's saying they're not fasting now because I'm with them. But when I go away, they will fast again. I don't know if you know the song. It would be great to play it, but the song by John Thurlow, it's from, I don't know if we have it in our resource center. CD is called Strong Love. The song's called Things Are Not Okay, but essentially what the song says are, things are not okay when the bridegroom is taken away. And on that day, they will mourn. And on that day, they will fast. And they will say, things are not okay. They're not okay when someone is missing, when someone is absent. Yes, they will say, things as they are not okay when someone is missing. And they won't be until you come back. They won't be until you come back. And so we say, Jesus, come back. We wait for you. Come make the wrong things right. Jesus, come back. It's an amazing song. It really captured my heart the first time I listened to it because I thought, sounds pretty pessimistic, doesn't it? But I thought, you know, it's actually an amazing song about the reality of that. Another thing that's absolutely fascinating is something called the mikvah, known as the baptism tanks. You can go to that next slide too, by the way. There's that passage. So the mikvah is a Jewish custom, is that both the bride with a female witness and the groom with a male witness on the night before their wedding would separately immerse themselves in a mikvah of living water, which is like a baptismal tank that they just enter into, and it's living water, which means the water pours in, and then there's a water that pours out, so it's not a stagnant water. And it's a Hebrew word for the word immersion or the word baptism. And so before the witness, each one, the bride-to-be, the groom-to-be, you know, so the female with the female witness, the male with the male witness, they would acknowledge any physical or emotional ties that they may have had with any other man or woman before that day. Then they would immerse themselves to cleanse and repent from all ties of their past, and they're considered born again at that time, like newborn babes, for their wedding day. In that waters of baptism. How awesome that we had baptisms this morning. Right? It's a symbol of our being born again. Now, how intriguing it is that excavations, archaeological excavations, have discovered in the Temple Mount in Jerusalem, there's probably around five, they've excavated all sorts of mikvahs, because 5,000 people, it says, were baptized in Acts chapter 2 when the Holy Spirit came. And so we saw all these mikvahs, all these baptismal tanks right there. And how intriguing it was that John the Baptist, who was known as the friend of the bridegroom, took people out to be baptized in the wilderness prior to his introduction of the bridegroom. And how intriguing that Moses, who also is recognized as a friend of the bridegroom, brought the children of Israel up to Mount Sinai. And by the way, up there in Mount Sinai in Exodus 19 was a wedding feast. It was a wedding ceremony on the day of Pentecost that was to take place for their marriage to God. And he told them to first cleanse themselves in Exodus chapter 19. First, we need to be cleansed before the wedding. How intriguing is it that many Jewish scholars believe that the very first friend of the bridegroom was none other than God himself in Genesis 2:22, when he brought Eve, who he had just created, and brought her to the man as the friend of the bridegroom. How intriguing that in the same way that four men carry the palanquin, or that carriage, that catch up the bride, and yet 1 Thessalonians 4, 16 to 17 declares that the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, and then we who are alive and remain will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and we shall always be with the Lord. So there's a catching up and a being caught up in that. How intriguing it was that Jesus makes the statement, "It is finished," while hanging on a cross, which echoed the very words that the bridegroom would say to the bride's father after he'd paid the full payment of the mohar, or the bridal price. He would be there signing it, paid the bridal price, and he would say, "It is finished." And Jesus, hanging on a cross, becoming a curse for you and I, utters, "It is finished." How intriguing it is that at this very minute, Jesus, our bridegroom, is building a bridal chamber, a huppah, that he's going to bring his bride to at that appointed day in the future that only the Father knows, not even the angels in heaven. How awesome and intriguing it is. How awesome and intriguing that Jesus gave John that small sneak preview into what would happen in times to come with Revelation 19 and Revelation 21, you know, the time of the apocalypse. And we're told, as was mentioned earlier, at that time that there would be a dazzling and a glorious bride adorned for her husband who would come out of a marriage huppah with her king, as she is presented together with him before the eyes of all those that would marvel upon the beauty of the bridegroom with the bride. Absolutely awesome. And so I trust that it's self-evident by now that we as the bride are to be fully prepared for that day when the bridegroom comes and captures us and catches us up to be with himself. And we'll be seeing him dazzling in all his beauty, and we also will be dazzling in beauty. Scripture says it'll be the day of the gladness of his heart. You know, I hope that we all are in a place where we recognize the emotions of the Father and the emotions of the Son. You know, it's part of the beauty of God is the incredible emotion. And as we, the betrothed, await him, we prepare ourselves in several ways. By getting our hearts ready, getting our hearts healed up. That's why I believe it's so crucial that it's one of the core values here that we have at Catch the Fire. Get your heart healed up. You know, I want to be ready for the bridegroom when he returns. If I've got unforgiveness in my heart to anybody else, you know, that's what a slight on the bridegroom if he comes back for the bride after he has spent all the time preparing the wedding chamber, preparing for the cup of consummation, preparing for the second half of the wedding feast, only to find that the bride had not made herself ready. And so we learn how to walk in love. That's how we get ourselves ready. We learn how to live in a community of love, even within our church, within our homes, within our business, within the marketplace. We learn what it is to walk in love. I believe we rehearse the appointments. I think we begin to look at things in a different eye, and we say, what are these appointments that we're called to rehearse? You know, I don't know if I mentioned it yet. I don't think I did, but we're actually rehearsing a Passover Seder on April the 9th here. And I don't think the tickets are for sale yet, but Juanita here at the front, if you can just wave, Juanita, she'll be one of the people that'll be helping out very integrally with that. And, you know, it's a great way to be prepared as we partake of what's known as the afikoman. Now, the afikoman is that little piece of unleavened bread that's in the middle of three, and it's fascinating because it represents Jesus, but that word afikoman actually means the satisfaction. You know, I want you to know this afternoon that if you don't know Jesus yet, we can eat. It would have been so good that if we'd have done communion this morning, but our people that put the communion out weren't around. They're down in another country, so we can go home and partake of communion together, but we can partake of the satisfaction. Isn't that an awesome thing? So we partake of the body and the blood of Jesus. And it's the last thing they ate at the Passover was the satisfaction. You know, I'm going to bring closure here to this now, but in the Passover, we had four cups of wine that were received. And the first two were really references to understanding that we really were in a place of slavery where there becomes a cry for freedom. It's a cry that says, free me, which is what happened to the slaves that were in Egypt. But the second cup that they drank was when God says, I'll rescue you from your bondage. I hear that cry. And that third one is one that we now call the cup of betrothal. It's that one that in the wedding ceremony, you know, the third cup of the Passover really is that first cup that would be provided when the bridegroom, the parents of the bridegroom and the parents of the bride come together. And he says, I'm going to buy you back. I want to transfer ownership from Pharaoh to myself in this covenant of marriage like they did at Mount Sinai. You know, and again, Luke 22 makes this reference. I've earnestly desired, Jesus says at the Last Supper, I've earnestly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I say to you, I'll never again eat it until it is fulfilled in the kingdom of God. And when he'd taken a cup and given thanks, he said, take this and share it among yourselves. For I say to you, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine from now on until the kingdom of heaven comes. And so what's he saying? I'm not going to drink of what? It's the fourth cup. So there's a fourth cup that awaits. And that fourth cup is known as the cup of consummation. It's the longing in the heart of the bridegroom saying, I wait for the time when we can finish the second half, because today you and I are betrothed to the bridegroom. But there's a time coming where the bridegroom will come back and we will partake together of this cup of consummation, where the finality in the kingdom to come, where we'll partake of communion. And so for you and I, when we think of communion, I want you to think about that, you know, that cup. Yes, the third cup, which is the cup of betrothal, also known as the cup of redemption, that we've been redeemed, but we've also been betrothed to him. But that fourth cup is that cup that we long for, that we wait. And so as we partake of communion in the future, I would urge you to partake of it in such a way that you drink of it and you remember that you get to say yes to Jesus again, as in a wedding ceremony. We get to say yes to him because it's a covenant that he's made, and he is a covenant-keeping God. I'm going to ask if we could have our worship team come forward, please. But you know, the message is a message that, you know, my heart and my prayer is it doesn't just stir our mind, but I want it to grip our hearts. It's a message that I believe needs to bring transformation. There's a saying that's going around the business world these days, and I hope I get it right, but that is that if you keep doing the things that you've always done, it's foolishness to expect any different results than you've always had. You know, and I say that because I feel like the Lord is calling us to begin to lay a hold of the rehearsals. You know, I say that to myself. I don't know. Like Leviticus 23, it's something that's coming alive in me because I'm reading this book. And again, we don't have it yet, but it's going to be made available next month. Okay, if you want the book, I can tell them, because they said, how many do we bring? And I said, I don't know. I think it's an incredible book. Most books I don't get to finish, not because they're not good, just because I've got too much on my mind. I'm reading it a second time because I'm thinking, I have to get this. I feel like we're making baby steps in this, but there's something about these rehearsals that I don't think are just Jewish feasts for the Jewish people. I believe they're the feasts of the Lord that we're all to partake of. I don't know what it all looks like. You know, there's a feast of booths, you know, where you spend time in a booth. Could it be that that's like the huppah? You know, it's like the the bridal chamber that is being readied, because at the last time during this Feast of Tabernacles, the bridegroom's going to return during a Feast of Tabernacles, and we're all going to spend time with him together in the huppah. That maybe during that season in the fall feast, we're all going to engage this. I don't know. You know, I speculate, but I do know that the spring feasts were fully fulfilled in Jesus Christ. He fulfilled them perfectly. I believe that for those of us that carry that royal anointing, that heart of a king, because it's the glory of God to conceal a matter, it's the glory of kings to search a matter out, that we've been given an invitation to search out this matter and to say, Lord, the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven that in Mark chapter 4, when you spoke to your disciples, have been given to the disciples. Lord, I want to partake of these mysteries. I want to have an understanding of the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven. I want to give you an invitation today that if you feel like you want to just step into doing things a little differently, enjoy the preparation as the bride for the bridegroom that's coming back, I want to welcome you to come to the front and really afresh consecrate yourself before him and say, Father, I want to be prepared as a bride. I'm not going to judge myself by my past, because I'm trusting that every one of you have gone through the mikvah, gone through the waters of baptism. You know, you've been cleansed and you've been washed and you've been renewed and made new, known. And there's this betrothal ceremony that's taken place in our lives, but there's a deep, deep passion in the heart of the bridegroom that's longing for the bride to prepare herself and make herself ready, even as he himself is in heavenly places, preparing that bridal chamber for the wedding feast that is to come. And like, you know, our founding pastor, John Arnott, has so phenomenally declared, it's about a wedding. You don't want to miss the wedding, church. You don't want to miss the wedding. You know, I would encourage you, wherever you are, just to come before this altar, you know, and say, Lord, I commit afresh again. I want to be prepared for the wedding. I want to be prepared for the return of the bridegroom. That when the sound comes out, behold, the bridegroom cometh, that I will be found ready, waiting, stepping through the other side, that for the joy set before him, he endured the cross. I believe for us, it's for the joy set before us that we need to endure some of the things that we have to endure in life. We endure sometimes relationships with other people. We endure the agony of abuse and misuse and, you know, unforgiveness and people that won't deal with the issues between us. Even for those of you online, I would urge you, you know, let's get on our knees and say, Father, I submit myself to you once again. Lord, I thank you that I've been cleansed and washed. But Father, I want to be prepared as the bride prepares for the bridegroom. Whatever, however, wherever, whatever it takes. In Jesus' name, amen. So God bless you. We're going to worship the Lord. You're welcome to come up and, you know, just partake together. Just commit your heart to him.
There's gonna be a way.